Okay, so am I audible to all of you? Can you hear me? Just confirm and then we go. So, you know, this Cochin Shipyard, this exam, your PDI is covering this exam in totality. And in my opinion, this is a very good opportunity and the paper will not be difficult. I think paper will be simple. So today I'm going to take 40 questions. As you know, technical questions are going to be 40 in 40 minutes. So I'm going to take 40 questions from entire syllabus of mechanical engineering today. And these questions will be very close to the what actually were asked in the previous exams. So on the basis of the memory, which students have sent us some questions, okay, this kind of question may not be exact same values, same data, but they are actually the questions which were asked in exam. So in my opinion, out of 40 questions, if you get more than, you know, 35, then your selection will be assured. That is what I feel. Question will be small but data oriented also. Like today I'm going to cover 40 questions. You will get an idea. Oh, they are very simple question. They are ticklish question. I could not solve it. So if you prepare well, you can get more than 35. If you don't prepare, it will be less than 30. That will make the difference. Paper is not difficult. So 40 question, 40 minutes, no negative marking. You understand paper is not going to be difficult, but yes, it is going to be data oriented and typically oriented for particular subjects. That is what we are going to do it. So can we start now? Just be attentive in entire session. Keep noting this entire session and keep seeing what kind of questions were there. And as I told you already, these questions are taken from actual Cochin exam, which students have gone and they've told us that these kind of questions were there in the exam. Okay, so let me go with the first question. So here I go. Question number one. This question was given as strain diagram. I'm going to write it here. Conventional stress strain diagram. What we are given is strain was 10%. In conventional stress strain diagram, you know what is conventional stress strain diagram? The strain was 10%. Find the true strain. Find the true strain. That is what you have to find. What is true strain? And answers given were 11%, 9%, natural log of 1.1, and natural log of 2. These were the four answer choices given. Now, see how we are to answer this question. That is a question, conventional stress strain diagram. yes, so Arun is saying that will they repeat the question? I don't think questions are repeated, but pattern is repeated. Like this question is based upon true stress strain and, you know, engineering stress strain. So we understand that, okay, stress strain diagram is important topic from where question can be asked. So all we need to do is we need to practice stress strain diagram to be sure that, okay, this kind of question I can do. Similarly, heat treatment process, similarly, particular section of question from particular, type of domain. So that can be repeated. Now, what we know is this. Now, see the concept here. This is stress strain diagram, and you know, this is a stress strain diagram for mild steel. This is called engineering stress engineering strain. This is called engineering stress engineering strain. Now, if you want to make a true stress strain diagram, it is something like this. True stress strain diagram comes out to be something like this. Now, in a true stress strain diagram, if I say epsilon T is the true, true strain, then this is how we calculate the true strain. Change in length over original length, change in length over instantaneous length, and we vary the length from original length to final length. Let us say initially the length of the workpiece was L0, final length is LF. Now this L is a variable, so what we get is natural log of L final over L original. That is what we know. This is a true strain. True strain means change in dimension over instantaneous dimension, not the original dimension, but instantaneous dimension. Now, what is, L final? That is, now we can put L final as, we can calculate this L final as nothing but natural log of L original plus change in length over original length. So this is what is the, I can write. So final length is original length plus some change in length. You understand? That is how we can write it. Or I can write it further as L natural log 1 plus delta L over L naught. And delta L over L naught is nothing but this is the engineering strain. So now he has given you engineering strain as 10%. You know, 10% means delta L over L naught given is, delta L over L naught given is 0.1. 10% strain means 0.1. 10% means 10 by 100. So this is 0.1, 1 plus 1, answer is C. I'm sure now you got this idea. So those of you who are saying, ki kaisa exam aayega, what kind of question we expect in actual coaching? If somebody tells us that this kind of question, true stress strain, conventional stress strain question was asked, so this becomes important topic for us. Yes, they refer the previous year paper. They refer the previous year paper, especially when paper is not there. They have not released the paper. So they refer the paper and hence it can become important for us. Good. Is this done for all of us? Any question related to this question? Any question? Yeah. Let's go forward now. I go to question number two. Second question. And I'm very sure you people can answer this question. What is the Poisson's ratio? Poisson's ratio for a material he has given, mild steel. Mild steel is in range. And you have to find out the range of Poisson's ratio for mild steel. 0 to 0.1, then 0.1 to 0.2, then 0.2 to 0.3, and 0.3 to 0.4. These are the four answer choices. 0.3 to 0.4. So this is the Poisson's ratio. You know what is Poisson's ratio? Poisson's ratio is nothing but negative of lateral, strain over longitudinal strain. Lateral over longitudinal strain. That is what the Poisson's ratio is, negative, because these are opposite sign, right? So this is what is the Poisson's ratio. Now, which one do you choose the answer for your case? Okay, answer for that is this C. Now, let me give you the value of Poisson's ratio for some materials. Cast iron 0.2 to 0.26. So cast iron is in this range. Then we get steel. Steel is 0.27 to 0.3. Then we get rubber. You know, rubber has very high, 0.5. Cork, almost zero. Then we get stainless steel, 0.3. And if we get copper, it is 0.34. So that means we should know the data. What kind of data is required? We need to have the data about shear strength, yield strength, modulus of elasticity, modulus of rigidity. These values are to be revised, because in the actual, because you know, this is a Cochin shipyard. Shipyard means these guys deal with this thing, you know, this material and material properties and those things. So they are important for them. And hence, yeah, so somebody is saying C, somebody is saying D, very, very close. So answer for that is C. Let me go to next question. So question number three, I'm giving you this as bending moment diagram. This A, B, and C, this is bending moment diagram. And the question is, point C represents what? Point C represents, and then he gives answer choice, shear force application. This is the application of shear force. Then point of contraflexure, then point of inflection, that is there and D couple. What is point C? That is also the answer question revised by someone. That sir, there was a BMD given and there was a sudden jump in the BMD, something like this. And he asked in the question, what is that sudden jump? What is that representing? Okay. Answer is coming from Arun, point of contraflexure. Arun, you are wrong. You are wrong, Arun. It is not point of contraflexure, actually. It is not the point of contraflexure. And point of inflection, it is not that also. It is couple. Answer is couple. So whenever in the BMD you get sudden jump, whenever in BMD you get sudden jump, there is always couple application into that. Why I'm saying not point of contraflexure? Let me tell you that also. Point of contraflexure is that point where BMD changes its sign. It is changing, no doubt. But bending moment is zero also at that point. In this case, bending moment is not zero here. Bending moment is changing sign, but not zero. So it does not become point of contraflexure. This is not the point of contraflexure. Yes, had it been like this, let us say this. Suppose I am giving you BMD like this. Let me make the diagram once again. Let me make the BMD like this. This is BMD. Now this is, yes, certainly the point of contraflexure. If I am giving you this BMD, then it is changing the sign, plus it is also zero here. And hence, now you can say this one is the point of contraflexure, because now at this point, this bending moment is zero, and also it is changing the sign. You can say point of contraflexure. This one is not point of contraflexure. There's a couple application. In fact, I can say this entire value is nothing but bending moment application. Now, similar to that, if I give you SFD, let us say, suppose this would have been SFD. This would have been SFD. Then I would have said, okay, this is nothing but shear force application. Then it would have been shear force application. So if there is a sudden jump in BMD, that is the bending moment. If there is a sudden jump in shear force, then there is a sudden moment in shear force diagram, then application of shear force. That concept you please remember, from there question can be asked. Okay, let's go for next question. I go to question number four now. Viscoelasticity is related to, let's see whether you answer. Viscoelasticity is related to what? I give you answer choosing. Number one, this is plasticity with deformation. That is answer choice number A. Second comes is elasticity with deformation. Choice number C. Time bound. Now, viscous and elastic behavior. Time bound, viscous and elastic behavior. Strain independent of stress. So you are to answer, what do you understand by viscoelasticity? What do you mean by viscoelasticity? That is a question. You know what the answer is? Answer is this. Viscoelasticity. Viscous also and elasticity behavior also. Now what is viscoelasticity? It is the property of the material that exhibit both viscous and elastic characteristic when deformation is produced. So let me write the definition. What actually is the viscoelastic? It is the property to display both viscous and elastic behavior when deformation takes place. That is viscoelasticity. So do one thing. I'm going to cover 40 questions. Just write down how many are correct for you. I'm going to give you a chance. Write down how many are correct for you. If you score 30 plus, then this is good. I mean, it's not bad. 35 is very good. So 30 plus, no mistake, 30 plus if you score, then you know it is not 30. 30 plus is, that means you can, if you push yourself hard, then you can really do that. You can really do good. Then next 10 questions ke liye you need to prepare, but 30 plus will be from my side a good base to start with, right? Let me go for next question now. This is the question number 5. I'm giving question number 5 now. Delta allotrope of iron occurs at temperature. What temperature do you get it? 900 degrees centigrade and 1000 degrees centigrade. Then 1000 degrees centigrade and 1100 degrees centigrade. Then 1400 degrees centigrade and 1500 degrees centigrade and 1400 degrees centigrade and 39 degrees centigrade. 1400 degrees centigrade and 39 degrees centigrade. This is the question. So this is the question. Delta, you get delta between which range? Delta allotrope of iron occurs between what range? Now, you know, iron carbon diagram, say he has asked you questions. Iron carbon diagram is also important in now material science. That is also important. And from there also question have been asked. Yes, you're right. 1400 and 1539. So if I give you now briefly this diagram, already you have this. So this is the delta allotrope. So 1539 degrees centigrade, this is 1400 degrees centigrade, and you have delta here. After that 1912 you get gamma, and then you know 1912 to very you get alpha. This is how you get various allotropes. So alpha, you know, this is ferrite, and then austenite, gamma, and delta. So 912 alpha is up to 912. 912 to 1400 you get, you know, that gamma austenite, and then till 1539 you get delta. That was a question. So this iron carbon diagram is very, very important, and you should do that. Let's go forward now. So I'm going to now next question, that is question number 6. I told you what you have to do is, out of 40 question, how much is your score? I'm going to ask you at the end, how much did you score out of 40? Do honest appraisal. And if this works, I'm going to come again for 40 40 40. That will give you real understanding. And till your Cochin Shipyard exam, you should hit more than 35. And I'll make sure that I'm coming out with the entire paper, just realistic as Cochin. So today is the first, you do it, and at the end you are going to write and tell me how much is your score. Okay, so next question is, what is coordination number? What is coordination number? What is coordination number for BCC crystal? I'm giving you choice. Choice A, 4. Choice B, 6. Then 8. Then 12. So what is the coordination number for BCC crystal? Okay, so now let me give you the answer for that. What is coordination number for BCC crystal? Answer for that is 8. Let me tell you now. So for BCC, coordination number is 8. For FCC, it is 12. For hexagonal close packing, it is 12. For simple cubic, it is 6. Remember these. I'm giving you data also, so that it can be useful to you. It can be useful to you for preparation. And you know, if I cover 40, 40, 40, depending upon how much time availability I have, if I cover 40, 40 question for you, till your actual Cochin Shipyard exam, we can cover many questions. That's not a problem. So this is, keep remembering this. You never know what question comes in the exam. Okay, let me go for question number 7 now. Question number 7 is from machine design. Eye bolts are used for, and this is very, very important thing for shipyard, you know. I give you the choices. Prevent relative motion. To prevent relative motion between two parts, obviously absorb the shock, absorb shock and vibration, absorb the shock and vibration, then lift heavy objects, choice C. Then comes prevent loosening of threads. So why do you use eye bolts? Why do you use the eye bolts? What is the function of eye bolt? Why do you use the eye bolt? Prevent the relative motion between two components. Absorb the shock and vibration. To absorb shock and vibration, lift the heavy objects. Prevent loosening of threads. Why do you use eye bolt? The answer for that is C. Let me give you the diagram and then I'm sure you people will understand what I'm saying. This is the eye bolt. This is the eye bolt. You must have seen this. Now, and I'm to lift a very heavy object, something like this. This is crane hook. This is the crane hook and I'm lifting very, very heavy object. So this is the eye bolt and this is the purpose of the eye bolt. So answer for that is C. Eye bolt are used for this. Out of 40 question, how much you are getting? Honestly, you have to give me your appraisal at the end of the class. Question number 7. Okay, now let's go to next question. Question number 8. When nut is tightened by placing washer below it. When you place a washer below it and nut is tightened, bolt is subjected to compression, then tension, shear, and then combined load. That is the question. Go for it. Tick it if you know. When the nut is tightened by placing a washer below it. You know what is nut, what is bolt, what is washer. You should know that. Cochin Shipyard mein you will find many. Nut, bolt, washer. When you tighten the nut and there's a washer, what happens to the bolt? What kind of stress is induced in the bolt? Let me give you the diagram and I'm very sure you will find the answer also. Washer, nut, bolt, washer, nut, right? This is the bolt. So the moment you tighten the nut, you know, this is called nut. This is washer. And this is bolt. All of you know. When you do that, you need to understand that there's a tension in the bolt. Washer mein there is a compression, but you know, threads will take it forward, take it outward, and there will be tension force induced in the bolt. So that was the question asked on the basis of that. That is question number 8. Question number 9 is related to globular criteria is used for the mechanisms with, shall I say, single degree of freedom. Second choice is multi degree of freedom. Choice C, zero degree of freedom. Choice D, none of these. none of these. What is Grubler criteria in mechanisms? What is Grubler criteria in mechanisms? Okay, so let me give the answer for this first. Answer for this is A, single degree of freedom. You know, there is something which is called cutback criteria. This cutback criteria is used for finding degree of freedom in two-dimensional or plane mechanism, 2D or plane mechanisms. Plane mechanism or planar mechanism or this two-dimensional mechanisms. And there's a formula for that. Degree of freedom is equal to 3 times L minus 1. Number of links is L minus 2J minus H. Let me tell you clearly. F is the degree of freedom. L is the number of links. J is the number of lower pair and H is number of higher pair. H is nothing but higher pair. You know what is the meaning of higher pair? Point contact. J is the lower pair. You know surface contact. Lower pair. Surface contact. So all, you know, pin junctions are lower pair. So four bar mechanisms, these all are example of lower pair. Now what happens is, if I assume that there is no higher pair, and if I assume that degree of freedom is to be kept one, if degree of freedom is to be kept one, then the relation will be 3L minus 2J is equal to 4. This equation is called Grubler criteria. This is called Grubler criteria. So you make this criteria by assuming degree of freedom to be 1. So I'm very sure you people are aware about mechanisms and degree of freedom and Grubler's criteria and cutback criteria, something like that. So degree of freedom, planar mechanism, single degree of freedom, planar mechanisms. Some question can be asked from here that how many lower pairs should be there for these many links. So slider crank mechanism, four bar mechanisms, these all questions are based upon that. Let's go to question number 10 now. I come to question number 10 now. You are given a diagram, and in that diagram you are given a ladder. This end is A, this end is B. Now 1 meter length of the ladder, and this angle is 60 degree, and velocity of end A, it is falling down, VA is given as 1 meter per second. So this end is also going to go this side. We are to find out velocity of B. What is the velocity of end B? That is the question given to us. Let's say this is O. So answer choices are 1 meter per second, then 2 meter per second, then it is 1 by root 3 meter per second, and then D is root 3 meter per second. Root 3 meter per second. Ladder sliding down. Sliding down, ladder sliding down. That is a question. The ladder is sliding down, and we have to find out the basically velocity of this. Another very, very important question. So that is a question which was asked. And I'm telling you again, like, you have to mark it. And at the end, you have to tell me out of 40, how much you are scoring. And then I'll be in better position to tell you where your preparation level stands as of now and keep improving it. That is what we will do. So now this entire question is based upon finding the instantaneous center. Finding the instantaneous center, you know what is the instantaneous center? Let us say this is the eye center. Now, if this is 1 meter, this is 1 cos 60, and this OA is 1 sine 60. Now, let us say the angular velocity when it is sliding down with respect to instantaneous center is omega. With respect to instantaneous center, angular velocity is omega. So VA is equal to IA into omega. I to A, that is a distance, V is equal to R omega. VB is equal to IB into omega. VA is given to me, VB I want to find out, omega gets cancelled out. This is IB over IA. But you know what? IB is nothing but, this is sine 60, and IA is nothing but cos 60, that makes it tan 60. So VB is equal to tangent 60 root 3 into VA. VA is 1 meter per second. And can you find out what is omega? Yes, if I put it here, then omega will be equal to VA over IA. What is IA? IA is nothing but cos 60, which is 1 by 2. This comes out to be 2 radian per second. So angular velocity of the ladder is 2 radian per second, and velocity of ladder can be this. So we understand that, okay, ladder as a now link and free falling body or falling body, we are to use instantaneous center concept, and from there we are to calculate it. Okay, so that was our 10th question. Now I come to question number 11. Coriolis acceleration exists. Where do you find Coriolis acceleration? Where do you get it? So when point moves along path, exists when point moves along a path that has tangential motion, choice A, radial motion, choice B, then there is linear motion, and then is D, rotational motion. These are the four choices given to us. So what is the answer? If Coriolis acceleration exists when there is a point which is moving along a path, and the path has what? What's the answer? Now let me give you a diagram here. Let's say OA is a link, and on the link there is a slider B which is moving outward like this, and this OA link has angular velocity omega OA. So the answer for that is rotation. Now this B link is going to experience the Coriolis acceleration. So that was the question asked from Coriolis force. That brings me to now question number 12. Spur gear has module 4 millimeter. So the module of spur gear is 4 millimeter. Find its circular pitch. Choice A, 2 millimeter. Choice B, 6 millimeter. Choice C, 12.56 millimeter. Choice D, 16.2 millimeter. For these questions, you have 1 minute, and one question within 1 minute. There are some numericals which are going to take 2 to 3 minutes. I got some numericals which student told me it took 2 to 3 minutes. So you have to save time somewhere else. Now what is circular pitch? Pi into M. What is M? Diameter over number of teeth. And what is M? Module. 4 millimeter. So what is pitch? 3.14 into 4. That comes out to be 12.56. So answer is 12.56 millimeter. That is a pitch. Yeah. So that is the pitch, circular pitch we have got. Now that brings me to question number 13. Chills used in casting for, chills are used in casting for, choices are impart strength to casting, number 2 impart stability to casting, C, remove defects. D, directional solidification. Directional solidification. There was one question on chills in Cochin Shipyard exam. So you should know why chills are used. What are the chills? Directional solidification. Chills are nothing but they are metallic pieces. They are metallic pieces made up of same metal as that of the casting. You put it in the mold cavity. When the molten melton is poured, then metal will get, that will melt, and when it will melt, it will take heat from the molten metal, and that will facilitate the solidification at that spot. So you can control the solidification and hence the grain structure, and hence prevent the defects also. Yes, you prevent the defects also, otherwise there will be defects. But the prime, the best answer is directional solidification. The best answer is directional solidification. Now that brings me to next question 14. And this question now is about DC welding machine. DC welding machine has linear voltage current characteristic. Characteristic. So there's a DC welding machine and it has a linear voltage current characteristic. What is given is open circuit voltage is given as 80 volt and short circuit current is given as 300 ampere. That is given. Find the current. Find the current for extracting maximum power from machine. Now that looks like a small numerical here, and answer are 100 ampere, then it is 150 ampere, then it is 200 ampere, and then it is 250 ampere. So that is a question from voltage current characteristic, and that is the answer we have to find it out. Now, you know, voltage current characteristic V in normally is inversely proportional to current. Let us say this is voltage and this is current. What is short circuit current? When the voltage is zero. What is open circuit voltage? When the current is zero. Open circuit voltage is given as 80 volt. Short circuit current is given as 300 ampere. So you cannot go beyond this now. You cannot go beyond this. Can you find out the equation of this straight line? This equation is Y is equal to minus MX plus C. Y is voltage. Slope is nothing but tangent of theta, which is nothing but open circuit voltage over short circuit current. Open circuit voltage over short circuit current. Negative sign because the slope is negative. Sorry, minus MX plus C, and X is nothing but current, and C is nothing but the intercept on Y axis, that is equal to 80. So this is the equation, voltage current equation. This is the equation between voltage and current. So we assumed it to be linear, but it is, as you know, the relation is inverse. So open circuit voltage, short circuit current, Y is equal to minus MX plus C. This is the equation. Now, what is power? Power is voltage into current. Just write in place of voltage this expression. It comes out to be, if I'm not wrong, this is then 0 gets cancelled out, 2 and 15. 80 minus 2 by 15 I into I. Now, this power is a function of current. Now, for maximum power, dp over di should be equal to 0 for maximum power. The moment you solve this equation, what you get is I 150 ampere. For that, now you should have done 150 ampere is the answer for this particular question. So this is question number 14. Coming to question number 15, getting design. Getting ratio in casting refers to ratio of areas, choice A, sprue, then runner, then ingate, B, sprue, then runner, then mold cavity area, C, runner, sprue, then ingate, D, ingate, mold, sprue. Tell me what is the answer for that. Getting ratio means what? Yes. So getting ratio is nothing but it is A, and this is how the design is. So suppose there is a pouring basin, then there is a sprue, then splash core, and then there is a ingate, and you have this is the mold cavity. So this is the area of sprue, area of runner, and area of ingate. So this is the sprue, and then comes runner, and then comes ingate. So it is the ratio of these three, that is what is the getting ratio. That comes to question number 16. Now in the question number 16, what is the refractiveness? Yes, that was the question asked in Cochin Shipyard exam. Choice A, ability of molding material. Ability of molding material to withstand high temperature. Is that the answer? Second, ability of molding material to withstand high pressure. Choice C, refers to brittleness and strength of molding material. Next, high hot hardness of mold material. You know, you should not answer the question unless until you have read the question thoroughly. So you are to answer this question, what is refractiveness? So answer to this question is yes, ability of molding material to withstand high temperature. Yes, basically it is the property of molding material in which sand is a ceramic, you know, sand has very high melting point. So it does not get melted, it does not get into fusion state. So why do we use sand only? Because sand has very high melting point, melting temperature. Sand should not burn when molten metal is poured. Sand can stand up to a temperature of 1700 degrees centigrade. And that is the reason sand is used as a refractory material. So common Indian is asking that center available outside Kerala. Answer is no, it is in the Kerala. It is in Kerala. It is Cochin, I suppose. I don't think it is outside Cochin. That is the reason it's a great opportunity for people of that part, because others may not go there. So next question, 17 question. As per Lee Schaeffer theory, as per Lee and Schaeffer theory, shear angle phi is given by which expression? Shear angle is pi by 2 plus alpha by 2 plus beta by 2. Alpha by 2 plus beta by 2. I will tell you what is alpha beta. Pi by 4 minus beta plus alpha. See, pi by 4 minus beta by 2 plus alpha by 2. D, pi by 2 plus alpha plus beta. Now alpha is rake angle and beta is friction angle. You know, direct question based upon formula. There can be direct question based upon formula. As per Lee Schaeffer theory, shear angle is given by what? What will be, as per Lee Schaeffer theory, the shear angle? Pi by 2 plus alpha by 2 plus beta by 2. Alpha is rake angle, beta is friction angle. I told you there is 40 minutes, 40 question, no negative marking. For getting into Cochin Shipyard, what should be the target? 35 plus. Because even if you know 32, 33, rest if you guess, you should get more than 35. Entire syllabus, all the topics you have to do. Question will be simple, but covering entire syllabus. So this is answer B. You know, as per Lee Schaeffer, phi is equal to pi by 4 minus beta plus alpha. This is as per Lee and Schaeffer theory. But then there is another theory which says pi by 4 minus beta by 2 plus alpha by 2. That is Ernest Merchant theory. Don't confuse between two. Ernest Merchant theory says phi is pi by 4 minus beta by 2 plus alpha by 2. And Lee Schaeffer says pi by 4 minus beta plus alpha. So this is the question from that. That brings me to question number 18. We have to do 40 questions. I'm sure you are writing ABC, and the end we will do analysis how much you scored, right? So if doubling the cutting speed, if doubling the couple this cutting speed reduces to life to 1/8 of original, find Taylor's tool life index, and answer is 1/3, 1/2, 1/4, 1/8. So if doubling the cutting speed reduces tool life to 1/8 of original, find Taylor's tool life index. Now what is Taylor's equation? Vt raised to power n is equal to constant. V1 t1 raised to power n is V2 t2 raised to power n. Now when we double the cutting speed, V2 is 2 times V1, 2 life 1/8 of the original. T2 is T1 by 8. Put these things here. When you put these things here, what you get is n coming out to be 1/3. N is 1/3. Answer is A. That is the answer to this question. Let's come to question number 19 now. Fixed cost per month fixed cost per month is rupee 5000. Fixed cost per month is rupee 5000. Variable cost is rupee 2 per unit. You know, variable cost is per unit. Fixed cost is monthly 5000. Variable cost is rupee 2 per unit. Selling cost is rupee 7 per unit. To attain the profit of rupee 1000, find quantity produced per month. Answer A, 500. Answer B, 600. Answer C, 1000. Answer D, 1200. So you are given fixed cost, you are given selling cost, you are given the variable cost and profit. Now see this side. Total cost, fixed cost plus x times variable cost. X is number of units produced. Okay. Total revenue is nothing but selling price into number of units. Sales price is selling price per unit into number of units produced. What is profit? Sale minus total cost. That means this is X into S minus V minus F. That is how it is coming. So profit is given to us. So what is X now? We want to find out X. P plus F over S minus V. What is profit? 1000. 1000 plus 5000, 6000 over 5. It comes out to be 1200 units. So answer is, we are getting here 1200 units. Answer for this is D, 1200 units. Now that comes to question number 20. Question number 20 is about Delphi technique. Delphi technique is used. Where do you use Delphi technique? Choice A, inventory management. Choice B, quality control. Choice C, material management. Choice D, forecasting. So for what purpose do you use the Delphi technique? For which purpose do you use Delphi technique? I use Delphi technique for, you know, forecasting. What is Delphi is, you know, when you do the brainstorming session of experts, you give them questionnaire and then you change it and give them new questionnaire, and that keeps on going. Lot of survey is done. That is how it keeps on moving. So that is called Delphi technique. Answer is D. Next question, I think, is related to your Cochin shipyard only. Shipbuilding yard. Yes. Now from this part also many questions are asked. Shipbuilding yard is example of choice A, fixed layout, then product layout, then process layout, and then manual layout. I don't know, these are the choices given. These are the choices given. So these are the various layouts which are provided: fixed layout, product layout, process layout, and manual layout. So what is this example of shipbuilding? It is example of fixed layout. This is example of the fixed layout. Now let's go to question number 22nd. Air is compressed in a piston. So there is a piston cylinder mechanism from 0.5 to 0.1 meter cube. That is the compression. Pressure acting on piston is 100 kilopascal. Work done is, choices are 40 kilojoule, minus 40 kilojoule, then zero, then none. So there is a air which is compressed, and you have to tell how much is the work done when you compress it. What is the work done? That is the question. Now you see, this is the piston cylinder mechanism. So work done, P D V, from V1 to V2. P is constant, 100 kilopascal comes out. V2 minus V1. What is V2? V2 is 0.1 minus 0.5. This comes out to be 0.4. That means negative of 40 kilojoule. B is the answer for that. Very simple question. Don't think it is ticklish. Going to be simple question only. So that was the question from compression. Now question number 23. Isothermal work done. Isothermal work done in a process. Isothermal work done in a process is, gives you choices, P1 V1 minus P2 V2 over gamma minus 1, P into V2 minus V1, P1 V1 natural log V2 by V1, D, P1 V1 natural log V1 by V2, P1 V1 log of P1 by P2. Okay, so these are the four choices given. So what is the formula of work done in an isothermal process? What is the formula of work done in isothermal process? Answer for this is, if I draw isothermal process on PV diagram, you know, this is state 1, this is state 2. This can be written as P1 V1 log of V2 by V1 or P1 V1 log of P1 by P2. So not V1 by V2, but V2 by V1. That is the isothermal work. Question number 24. Engine works on Carnot cycle. Engine works on Carnot cycle between reservoirs at 1000 Kelvin and 500 Kelvin. Heat input is 1000 kilojoule and work done is 300 kilojoule. Find the efficiency. Now, efficiency is given as 33.33%, 50%, 25%, 75%. There is an answer choice which is given. Engine works on Carnot cycle, and this is what is given. You need to understand that if Carnot cycle is given to us, this is work output, heat input, T1, T2. You know, actual efficiency is work output over Q1, but Carnot efficiency is 1 minus T2 by T1 is the Carnot efficiency. So T2 is 500, T1 is 1000 kilokelvin, sorry. So that gives me 50% of efficiency. Question number 25. Find correct expression. Find the correct expression for a real thermodynamic cycle. Choice A, dQ by T cyclic integral less than 0. dQ by T cyclic integral less than equal to 0. dQ by T cyclic integral greater than 0. dQ by T cyclic integral greater than equal to 0. So you have to find out what is the correct expression for that. You know, answer for this is Clausius inequality. Clausius inequality. You know, it says that dQ by T cyclic integral less than 0 is real. dQ by T cyclic integral equal to 0 is for reversible cycle. And dQ by T cyclic integral greater than 0, not possible. Not possible. So answer for this was A. That was 25th question. And I'm sure you people are writing answers on your copy, because at the end we are going to make analysis. So now we come to question number 26. This is question number 26. 1 kg steam sample contains 0.4 kg water vapor. Dryness fraction will be, what will be dryness fraction? 40%, 20%, 60%, none of these. Not a difficult question, but as I told you, none of the question is difficult, but yes, it is only race between 5 to 10 questions. So what is dryness fraction is? You know, mass of vapor over mass of vapor plus mass of the water, that is total mass. Now this is given 0.4 and total is 1 kg. That comes out to be 20.4. That is 40% is the dryness fraction. So the dryness fraction is 40%. Now question number 27. In the steam power plant, reheating is done to, choice A, increase the efficiency, choice B, increase network choice C, decrease work input. Choice D, increase efficiency and network. So what answer will you hit? You know, to answer all the question, you people should have actually gone through entire syllabus. So Vizag Steel ke liye, agar aapko, if you have to clear Vizag Steel, you should have gone through all the syllabus and you should have knowledge about our entire syllabus. So very minute questions can also be asked. Answer for that is to increase the network. You know what is network? It is the turbine work minus compressor work. So reheating is basically done to increase the network output. That is the answer for this question. Next question is 28th question. So stroke volume in IC engine, stroke volume in IC engine is 300 cubic centimeter. Clearance volume, stroke volume is 300 cc. Clearance volume is 20 cubic centimeter. Compression ratio will be, that is what we have to find, 16, 14, 12, 10. What is compression ratio is? You know, total swept volume over clearance volume. So stroke volume plus clearance volume over clearance volume, 320 over 20. That comes out to be 16. So answer for that is A. So for this question, answer is A. Now I come to question number 29. Air standard efficiency of auto cycle. Air standard efficiency of auto cycle with compression ratio 4 and adiabatic index of 1.5 will be, answer choices are 33.3%, 25%, 50%, 75%. Air standard efficiency of auto cycle, if you are given the compression ratio and adiabatic index, done. What is auto cycle? Efficiency is 1 minus 1 by R raised to power gamma minus 1. 1 minus 1 by 4, 1.5 minus 1. 1 minus 1 by 2, 50%. So efficiency is coming out to be 50%. Okay, so this is all about, I think we have done 29 question, and once it is saved, I go for next question. So 40 question we are going to do, and you have to mark in your copy how many are correct. If it is more than 30, nothing to worry. Go to the exam with full preparation for next 1 month. Less than 30, you need to do analysis. Knowledge level is less. More than 35, very high chance. Don't miss any important thing. That is how we have to do it. So just give me a second and I think we proceed forward for next question now. Okay. So let's go for now. Next question. That is question number 30. Question number 30. Morse test is used to measure choice A, indicated power, brake efficiency, friction power. What is your answer for this? You know, this Morse test is always used to find out the indicated power, because there are the engines, and Morse test is used for multiple engines. It cannot be used for single engine. There are multiple engines, and then you keep on firing one engine. You fire all the engines first, calculate the brake power, then you do not fire one engine, fire all other engines, again calculate the brake power. Difference of these two gives you indicated power for the engine which was not fired. That way you calculate the indicated power for all the engines, all the cylinders, and then entire engine. So we get indicated power for entire engine by not firing one by one cylinder, something like that. So multi-cylinder engines ke liye you use the Morse test. Okay, next go for next question. Question number 31. Air as refrigerant is designated as R717, R727, R729, R744. Refrigerants have nomenclature, right? This is not organic, this is inorganic. Air is inorganic refrigerant. How do you write the commercial formula? Then you write 700 plus molecular weight of the component substance. What is the molecular mass of air? 29. That is 29. So R729. C is the answer. Refrigerant and their properties. Okay, now question number 32. Sensible heating component is double the latent heating component. Sensible heating component is double the latent heating component. Find sensible heat factor. Choices 66.67%, second choice 33.33%, 25%, 50%. Right? Just calculate and tell me what is the sensible heat factor. What do you think is the sensible heat factor for this? How do you calculate sensible heat factor? Sensible heat factor is sensible heat plus latent heat. Now let's divide throughout with latent heat. Mathematically, I can write it like this. Sensible heat over latent heat plus 1. Sensible heat is double the latent heat, means 2 over 2 plus 1, 2 over 3. What is 2 over 3 in percentage? A is the answer for that. Air conditioning, this is used. Let's go for question number 33. This is from heat and mass transfer. A 50 millimeter outside dia, 50 millimeter outside dia pipe, outside diameter pipe is to be insulated is to be insulated using insulating material. Using insulating material having thermal conductivity 0.1 watt per meter Kelvin if convective heat transfer coefficient is 5 watt per m square Kelvin, find the critical radius of insulation. Find the critical radius of insulation. Let me give you the choice. 10 millimeter, 50 millimeter, 20 millimeter, 40 millimeter. Try to solve it. Try to see what is the answer for that. Okay. Critical radius of insulation can be calculated as K over H, 0.1 over 5, 0.02 meter, that comes out to be 20 millimeter. As I told you, in Cochin Shipyard, paper which you will get, you have to score more than 35. And this paper which I have taken, this questions which I am giving you today, they are easy degree of difficulty. We have to go to moderate and then difficult degree of difficulty as the preparation goes on. I will keep on conducting such things again, but in you have to solve this and try to see where you hit, what is your score coming. We go to question number 34. Nusselt number is 4000. Reynolds number is 40 and Prandtl number is 20. Prandtl number is 20. Find the Stanton number. Even if you have not heard about this, sometime he will give you the question. 5, 10, 100, 200. Stanton number is equal to Nusselt number, Reynolds number and Prandtl number. 4000, 40, 20. Comes out to be 5. A is the answer for this. We come to next question. 35. Stream function is given as psi is equal to 2xy. Psi is equal to 2xy. Find the velocity at point 1, 2. Choices are 2 meter per second, 4 meter per second, 20 meter per second, root 20 meter per second. Stream function is given and you have to find out what is the velocity at this particular point. Very simple. Total velocity vector is ui plus vj. U is curly psi over curly y. V is minus curly psi over curly x. Curly psi over curly y. Curly psi over curly y gives me, when I partially differentiate it with respect to y, gives me 2x, x is 1. It gives me 2 meter per second. Minus curly psi over curly x gives me minus 2y. That gives me minus 2 into 2, minus 4 meter per second. Now, if I want to find out velocity, it is u square plus v square under root. That gives me 4 plus 16 under root. That gives me root 20 meter per second. Simple question. Next question. A liquid jet is coming out of nozzle kept at 60 degree with vertical axis. So there is a nozzle which is kept at 60 degree to vertical axis and liquid jet is coming out of that. If u is velocity of jet, find maximum height attained by jet. G is acceleration due to gravity. What are the choices? U square by G, U square by 2G, U square by 4G, U square by 8G. Now, let me give you nozzle and let me give you the jet. This comes out with velocity u. This angle is theta. The moment jet is thrown from the nozzle, it is like a paraprojectile, parabolic path projectile. What is the maximum height? Any idea about this? U square sin square theta over 2g. You need to remember this formula. U square sin square theta over 2g. But you know what? This angle is given as 60. So what is theta? 30 degree. What is sin 30? 1 by 2. 1 is sin square 30, 1 by 4. U square over 8g. That is answer for this. Question number 36. Now we come to question number 37. Bullet of mass 1 kg is fired from gun of mass 10 kg. There is a bullet which is fired from gun of mass 10 kg. With velocity u meter per second. That is the velocity of the bullet when it is fired from gun. Ratio of kinetic energy of bullet and gun is, give you choice, 10, 11, 1.1, 1. You know, conservation of momentum. Initial momentum, any idea? Initial momentum of gun and bullet is zero. So final momentum should also be zero. Final momentum is m1v1 plus m2v2. Initial momentum of gun and bullet is zero. It is not fired. Final momentum should also be zero because there is no external force acting. Second law of Newton. M1 is 1 kg. M2 is 10 kg. V1 is U. So V2 is minus U by 10. This is called recoil velocity of gun. This is called recoil velocity of the gun. Minus U by 10. Minus U by 10. Now, what is the kinetic energy of bullet over kinetic energy of gun? Half of m, velocity of bullet is u square, and half of mass of gun, velocity is u square by 100. Now this is 1, this is 10, half gets cancelled out, solve it. And you find it to be coming out to be 10. Why? Because this is 10, this is 100, it will come out to be 10. That is question number 37. Question number 38. Two masses, 2 kg and 8 kg. Are moving with same kinetic energy. Two masses are moving with same kinetic energy. Ratio of magnitudes of their momentum is choice A 0.25, choice B 0.5, choice C 0.625, choice D 1. That is the question. You know what is kinetic energy? Kinetic energy is half of mv square. What I do, m square v square over 2m. Can I write like this? M square v square by 2m. What is mv? This is the linear momentum. P square by 2m. So kinetic energy is p square by 2m. No, because kinetic energies are given equal. So what is happening is p1 square over 2m1 is equal to p2 square by 2m2. What is the ratio of magnitudes? So p2 by p1 is equal to 2 gets cancelled out. Gives me m2 by m1 under root. What is m2? 8 by 2 under root gives out to be 2. So 2 is not there, 0.5 is there. So let's hit 0.5. Maybe any ratio it is given. Question number 38. Only 2 more questions we have to go. 39. Which of the following is pressure is mechanical pressure gauge. You know, there's a mechanical gauges also. So let me give the names. Diaphragm, dead weight, Bowden tube, all of above. Pressure can be measured by mechanical gauges, by manometers also, you know. So, sensors also. What is this? Which one is the mechanical gauge? Yes. All of above. Understand one thing. Cochin Shipyard paper will be set by them only. People of Cochin Shipyard. So, they feel like asking those questions which are somewhere related to the things which they see. The things which they observe. And you have to prepare those topics very well. Now, last question for the day. 40th question. Body weighs 392.4 Newton in air and 196.2 Newton in water. In water. What is volume? What is volume in meter cube? That is the question. Answer choices are 0.01 meter cube, 0.02 meter cube, 0.03 meter cube, 0.04 meter cube. The weight of the body in air is this. When it is put in water, the weight is this. What is the volume? What is the loss in weight? Loss in weight is 392.4 minus 196.2. That is 196.2 Newton. Now visualize this way. Suppose the bodies of weight, bodies of volume V, and it is thrown in water. There is a buoyancy force acts on the body. The weight of the body was this, but now it is this. The loss of the weight is buoyancy force. It is because of the buoyancy force. And how do you calculate buoyancy force? Is equal to volume of the body into density of liquid, which is water, into G. Volume of the body, that is equal to the weight of the liquid. Volume of the body is equal to volume of the liquid displaced. So that is given as 196.2. Rho is nothing but 1000. G is nothing but 9.81. So this number is chosen such that you can divide it directly. Answer is coming out to be 0.02 meter cube. That brings me to an end of this beautiful session of your Cochin Shipyard paper. Now, if you can do one thing for me, just write there, how many marks are you getting out of 40? How many questions did you hit correctly? That's it. How many questions did you hit correctly out of 40? Just write it fast so that I ended up, there are 29 souls here listening to me. So just write how many questions did you hit correctly? Do that fast. Sudhir, poor performance. Go ahead, fast. Each one of you. Sudhir, you need to prepare nicely for this if you are targeting the exam. This was easy degree of difficulty. Cochin Shipyard mein, you can expect 3 degrees of difficulty. Easy, moderate, high degree of difficulty. 36 looks like good. Minitish, it looks like good. 36. But try to prove it in moderate and high degree of difficulty level paper. No, 19 is poor. Go ahead. Fast. Do it fast so that then I exit. Do it fast. How much you are getting? 19 is less. 36 looks like good. 12. China, you have got very less. Anas, you need to talk to me as early as possible. Very less. Go ahead fast. Do it fast. I tell you, the people, students from Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, you know, they have very good opportunity here. Prepare well for this exam. Okay, not a problem. Okay, 14th question you tried. So that means you tried somewhere 26. Out of 26, 19 looks like okay. Go ahead, next. Anybody else? Now let me give you the general opinion for this. If you are scoring 35 plus in this, that is a good performance. 30 plus, give you 100%. Less than 30, you need to prepare really 6-7 hours a day for this paper for next 1 month. I don't think date has come, but 27th October is the date to fill the form. If you are from southern states of India, fill this form. Number of seats are there. And I think there will be interview, 37-40 mechanical seats, 5 times. So I think 400-500 students, they will call for interview. You stand a really good chance and prepare it well. Okay, I prepared this question paper on the basis of feedback which I got from the students, those who are there in Cochin Shipyard, those who have written the exam, which we interacted, and from the internet, which we got the source paper, this kind of question were asked. From there I prepared. They are not that similar values. I mean, like, this value may not be there, but yes, loss of weight when the body is sinking, body loss of weight pe question aata hai. Something like that it was done, and you will get more such questions. Fine. Chalo, I end it up here only. All the very best to all of you, and I'll catch you next time again. Keep watching the videos. Thank you.